separate from that, hardly made it. Returned to Israel to find out that I still have a residual tumor. Flew back to Kelly and he told me, Avi, my friend, deep-seated, I can't remove it. You're lucky that it's benign. Wait for someone to invent a miniature microscope. Come back in 5 years and I'll resect the tumor. And I thought to myself, you know, with all due respect to this, I hardly made it this time. And, you know, I wanted to get married and to start my life. And how can you live like that? A zipper, you know, every 5 years they'll open and close me. And then I started learning that field to understand why the current technologies were not capable of performing my surgery. And this is the typical vision system that neurosurgeons or any complicated, whether it's cardiac or spine surgeon, would use. It's a huge microscope, expensive. It provides the surgeon a great stereoscopic vision, what people call today 3D. But it demands a relatively big opening, and while a big opening is still okay for a spine, it is definitely not for deep-seated tumors. And after 2 years of learning and investigating, I finally understood why couldn't great companies like Zeiss or Olympus shrink the size of this huge microscope to a few millimeters. I came up with a different invention, and by then the other company that I worked for got sold, and I started the Vision Sense. So the whole issue is that when you pave your way, and sorry for the pictures, when you pave your way as a neurosurgeon to get to the tumor, to resect it, to save the life of the patient, you damage vital tissues and the patient will become hemiparetic, meaning crippled, lose some of his mental abilities, develop seizures, etc., if he survives. And I was just too young to kill myself. I'll switch a bit forward. The technology that we invented does not use optomechanics. It's a semiconductor-based solution. And we provide 3D vision by mimicking an insect eye. As you know, insects, or now you know, have up to 8 eyes, but each eye can see depth perception. So what you see there on the scent, on the penny, is basically one of our sensors. It's 3 millimeters in OD, and it includes hundreds of thousands of miniature cameras. Okay? This is, I would say, a significant revolution for this relatively conservative market, bringing high-tech, and when I mean high-tech, it's not just semiconductor. It's also extremely advanced algorithms that I'll show you later what they do. Significantly reducing the size and the cost, if you wish, and allowing to perform different surgeries. So today, if you look at the bottom, my surgery that was done here, I have holes all over the place. I passed 4 surgeries in New York, Germany, and Israel for 6 years of my life. Today it would be done in probably half a day, and the patient would be released the next day with better gross total resection, better morbidity and mortality results. Okay, it's really significant. Thanks. We have various technologies for various solutions. This is the system that we sell direct. Up to date, we have no competition. We're the only company that has miniature stereoscopic cameras. We sell direct in the neurospine ENT markets. We license our technology to other markets. Till now, we focus only on medical. I don't know too many companies that defocus and manage to succeed, although we are aware of additional applications. In addition to providing stereoscopic vision or 3D vision, again, no headaches, no nausea in miniature forms, we also provide 3D measurements in real time of the scene with high accuracies, and are able to fuse an MRI or CT or ultrasound so the surgeon could see through. These are extremely sophisticated algorithms that took a decade to develop. Again, no competition, no one even close, no other company has these abilities. Our business model is basically selling a relatively expensive capital system with continuous revenue stream from the cameras, that basically kill themselves after 40 procedures. So pretty good business. I can only comment that this company, VisionSense, I started it as an Israeli company, and after lots of financial difficulties, I had to relocate to the US, and I'm like a hardcore Israeli. It was extremely difficult for me to give up and relocate, flip the company to become American with an Israeli subsidiary and raise money in the US. Today I live in Palo Alto. I will always be critical for all the people that say that huge companies could be developed in Israel, that I think that Israel lacks of course the patience, lacks the funding, and lacks probably the managerial experience. And if we, as a country, we want to grow to the next stage, someone has to provide this infrastructure. In my case, I'm saying it's a personal disappointment. I understand where VisionSense will go, and today the majority of the profits will go to the US and not to my country. This is one of the leading institutions. Today, our systems are sold in the US, Europe, Israel, whether through direct and distribution channels. We also have Zeiss, who understood, the biggest microscope company that were taking over their market. They signed a strategic agreement with us to distribute us in some territories. This is the BNI, this is the biggest hospital in the US, in Phoenix, and you could see a surgery using our system. You could only see now the nose, see that in the blue sheet you could see a nose, and this is also a laser, this thing, yeah. So here you could see the nose of here's the patient, okay? And this is the tip of the nose. This is an extremely sophisticated, deep-seated brain tumor removal. Okay, patient goes home the next day. You could see here our system. I would say that with all due respect to my old previous inventions in the motor vehicle and in communications, this for me on a personal basis took me to the next stage, to allow to save people with I think the most advanced technologies in these fields. So I'm honored to work with this company. Want to thank you all. Open to ask questions.
That's okay, I haven't have a mic. Well, really, that's an absolutely incredible invention that can really has moved things up, I would say, by a total game changer. And any of us here who have near ones and dear ones who've ever gone through anything what he went through, I think this is fantastic and he deserves our support. Thank you very much. And I'd like to bring our third panelist over, give him a hand.
Hi, I'm Murray Blackman, and I'll be talking to you about Gideon and maybe a little bit of history of how the whole Israel connection and why we're here. Gideon is a decision support tool that helps doctors diagnose diseases. So you could look at it as like a second opinion. It helps the doctor figure out, you know, if they're not sure what it is, they'll go to Gideon, they put in the symptoms, and it'll give them a differential diagnosis that'll show them what you might have. Let's say you were traveling in India, you got a fever, diarrhea, you come back, and especially if you're from a place where they're not used to seeing diseases that might exist in other places, it'll help the doctor figure out what you have. And on top of that, we also keep it updated, so we track infectious diseases from around the world and always have up-to-date information about those diseases in our system. So you can always track outbreaks and make sure that if there is an outbreak, it's there at the doctor's fingertips. And who uses Gideon? So we're used, obviously, by doctors at the point of care in hospitals. We also have a strong educational aspect used to teach doctors about how to treat patients, and so it's used in universities. And then we have a strong public health application where at the global level, companies like organizations such as the World Health Organization, CDC, the US CDC, and even at the county level, like Los Angeles County of Health, would use Gideon just to track what's going on in terms of outbreaks, in terms of if there are any new diseases that they should be aware of. For example, the World Health Organization has a meeting every morning where they get reports on what's happening around the world, and what they'll usually do is they'll run it through Gideon, see if there's any background information that they might not have, and help them figure out in terms of next steps. And now a little bit about the history of Gideon. We were founded before the web, so actually the first product that we had was on a floppy disk. I don't know if you guys remember what that was, but it was DOS-based. And it's an interesting story because I was in the same unit, 8200, I was just finished the Army. I was like, okay, what am I gonna do? I was just about to start university, and my uncle was like, hey, you know, you've got some software experience, why don't you, he ran the cath lab at Tel Aviv Medical Center. He says, why don't you do the computer-based record system? So that's kind of like was my introduction into the whole medical space. My background was more technical, so I don't have the medical background, but more the technology background. And that brought us, and he introduced me to my current partner who runs the microbiology lab at Tel Aviv Medical Center. So all our information is actually done in Israel. And then we migrated and went to Windows, CD, and then we finally went over the web, and that enabled us to really get to leverage some of the experience that I had at Netscape with a browser and use some of the things that I learned to provide a great interface so that doctors can really make it easy for them to use this product. Our latest application is taking the information that we have and boiling it down into electronic books. And so you can now take the information we have and actually just download it onto your PDA, your iPad, your iPhone, your Android device, or anything like that, and just carry it with you. So it's, you know, doctors want to look at ways to access the information easily. You can get it right now on any device. So that's kind of our latest iteration. And I'm sure as technology goes forward, we'll be tracking it, and we'll make sure that we make it easier for people to access the health professionals to access our information. And so you know, when I think about what's unique about a health product created in Israel, and you know, why Israel is a good feeding ground for creating new technologies like this, you know, what I think about is kind of like when you're naive and you don't know that you can't succeed, it's really a good entrepreneurial trait because you'll just try anything. And I think that's kind of what's nice about Israel is like anything kind of goes, and it's very easy to try things and just see if it works. And that's why I think it's a really great feeding ground for entrepreneurs. I wanted to keep this presentation short because I know that we went over with a bunch of others, and I see some.
I promised to ask you some questions.
Okay. So. Bottom line, Gideon, we help doctors make better decisions, and be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much.
Hi.
So we've just heard from these panelists, and I'm just going to ask a few questions, and then I hope that we will have time to let some of you ask a couple of questions of these great entrepreneurs here. So I'm going to start with Martin, and then we'll go down the line here. I want to talk about some of the greatest challenges in some of these things. What do you really see as the greatest challenges and barriers in bringing medical wonders to fruition?
I can speak only really with respect to drugs, because the world of drugs and the world of medical devices, again, their stage of development is totally different. I mean. You know, the underlying science under medical devices is essentially 100% perfect. I mean, you don't wonder is this going to work? You wonder if it's going to do the job that you need it to do, if it will sell, all this kind of stuff. But I mean, the physics, the equations, you design your product on a computer, and it, then when you make it, if it doesn't work, again, it may not do the application that you want, but it has to physically work. If it doesn't work, you fire all your engineers, because they had, all right. You know, in the drug world, you take the 100 top pharmaceutical research directors in the world, and you ask each one of them to think of, you know, 10 ideas or whatever. So you end up with, I don't know, 1,000, 10,000 ideas. Bottom line, if one or two of them actually work for the disease that they thought it was going to work for, it's a miracle. Because no one understands the interaction between chemistry and the body. It's just totally a black box at this point in time. Now what will happen, because of the way drugs are discovered experimentally, you discover them because they do something to a receptor, to an animal, or whatever. So then when you do your clinical experiments, you may find out that that drug, that chemical really does something good. Almost every major drug that's out there today started its clinical studies for something else, but as they were doing their thing. So I guess the bottom line is, for drugs, the biggest problem is simply they don't work. They usually don't work. That's it. You know, and all of this stuff, I think investors who worry about business models or competition, competition drives prices and profits up in the drug business. I mean, all of these things are academic. The only question is, does it work?
Thank you. Uri, would you like to comment on this? And then I'll take another question.
So can you just repeat the question?
Sorry about that.
The question was about the challenges. The question is about the challenges. What do you see are the greatest challenges to bringing drugs to fruition?
Well,
to bring medical wonders to fruition.
We're not in the drug business, yeah. But in our information business, one of our biggest challenges was, when we came out, we were way ahead of our time. Like, doctors weren't used to using computers to get information. Google has done a lot to kind of, it's called Google Diagnosis, where doctors type in some symptoms and like kind of see what Google has to say. So it's not a lot, also a new generation of doctors that are used to using computers. So our problem has been more the way doctors have been educated, that they're like, almost like God, where they know everything, and coming to admit that actually they don't know everything, but they can use these tools to help improve care. So I think for us, that was the one challenge. The second challenge is the medical records. In Israel, 97% of medical records are electronic. In the US, it's only like 25%. And this causes a big problem, because there's no way to really insert a clinical information system like ours into the workflow of the doctor, because they're using paper. So how are you going to say, oh, using paper, okay, now use a system to diagnose a disease? You know, once we have a much higher percentage of medical records, it'll be much easier to insert our decision support in the workflow of a point of care physician.
Great, and I'm going to add one more question, which I'll go to Ari, which actually is about reducing the cost of healthcare, which is so critical. And obviously, with continued pressure to reduce the costs, to what extent would you say, and you're kind of an obvious example of it, does medical innovation can actually contribute to lowering those costs?
I don't think that it's about, sorry to disappoint, it's not about cost reduction. It's about taking medicine to the next step. Typically, it will involve significant research and development. I will argue, Martin, with you, that we fought with science big time, and took us almost a decade to develop a technology. We had to develop simulations because we couldn't use not geometric and not photonics optics as an example. Okay, so when you look at the grass of the neighbor, it always looks greener. When you check your grass, it's always rotten and has issues, right? So I know my grass.
I would like to respond to that.
Okay. And
you may.
Any new technology will always be very expensive, whether it's for TVs, cars, and you should expect the same for medicine. Initially, you would begin with high-end, expensive, lucrative products, whatever they are, and eventually, as volumes increase and usage increases, prices will decrease. Okay, it's the same for everything. I would say that we look at ourselves as a high-end treatment, you know, saving so much money for the hospital, shortening hospitalization from 5 days to 1 day, improving clinical results, etc. And we want our premium, you know, we are a VC-based company and we need to provide some return. Okay, so it's not about reducing cost, it's about developing the next forefront of medicine.
But it seems to have a practical result in that case. Anyway, Martin, a quick one, yeah, and then I'm gonna...
Yeah, it's interesting. I'm okay. It's interesting because, in my judgment, your response was one of our big problems that we have. Well, I think one of the problems in the world in understanding what's going on in life science versus high tech is, I disagree with you. I doubt if you've done any science. Zero, all right? You've done unbelievable technology. But show me one physics principle that you guys have discovered that wasn't known before you did your work. I will bet that every physics principle that you rely on has been known for 50 years, mm-hmm. All right? There is a total difference between science and technology, but because we live in a high-tech world where science, where the physics is so totally predictable that we confuse those words. You hear people talking all the time, technology, science, they're totally different concepts. Science is understanding how the life works at a molecular level. What are the underlying basic laws that make things happen the way they do, all right? Technology is understanding that and making use of it in a practical way to bring good things to humanity. I don't think there's been any science done in high, this doesn't mean it's bad. It means it's wonderful, it's fantastic. You know, the brightest people in the world now can go after high tech, and if they can think of something and they're really smart, they know the scientific principles that underlie, you know, their technology and their advances in technology. But the science behind a personal computer existed 100 years or 50 years ago.
This is so cruel. I wanted to have more questions. This is a discussion that just got started, and I'm afraid that we have to end it here. But it can go on outside the corridors. And you can come on. So my profound apologies, it's much too interesting and short, but thank you very much. Give the panel a great hand.
If I may?
Yes. The last word.
Whoever wants to see a demo, I brought a demo system. You could see videos of surgeries, either transnasal or transkey eyebrow or behind the ear or posterior fossa, all of them like miniature opening. Okay, you need 3D glasses and you need to stand like 3-4 meters away from the display. Feel free.
Thank you.
It's worth seeing. I saw it last night. Worth seeing.
Thank you very much, everybody.
I want to thank each of our panelists. Thank you, Isabel.
Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Martin.
Thank you.
Thank you, Avi. And thank you, Murray. It's a delight. And I also want to ask you all to think about now which of the pavilion companies you haven't seen. We have a fantastic group here of from our medical side, and I know that is our style. Everything here is an hors d'oeuvre. Nothing is long enough, and we always want more information, and we hope that we're leaving you on this medical discussion with a taste in your mouth of, gee, I'd love to know more, because the area of medical devices, information technology in healthcare, and drug discovery is a burgeoning area in Israel and here. So thank you, panel. This is fabulous. Thank you. Okay. With that, I'd like to introduce Eran Wagner, who will talk a little bit more about some of our other pavilion folks. And then we're going to hear from the wonderful Yossi Vardi.
So Yossi is already angry with me. But I'm not going to take too much of your time. I think it's important to present a couple of additional companies that are out here in the pavilion, so that you know who they are, you can walk over, talk to them, and understand and learn a little bit more about what they do. The first couple of people, Anon Leibovich and David Elfersi, are you guys here? If you can stand up, from Marvell. I don't think I need to present Marvell and add too many words. You've heard a lot today about their microprocessor technology and DSPs. They're not out here, okay? They're out there. David, right? So David is right there. If you have any questions about Marvell, please feel free to walk over and talk to them. Robert Rothschild from the American Technion Society. As you know, the Technion is a world-leading university in the areas of technology. There is a friendship circle here and an organization that was built to support the Technion. Feel free to walk over to Robert if you're interested in taking part of this wonderful activity. And last but not least, snappily, do we have Yael here? Yael, are you out here? They do some amazing things with 3D printing. And if you want a really cool business card or print using some very nice looking 3D features, please walk over to their little booth, ask for Yael, and she'll show you everything. Thank you very much, and we'll continue.
Thank you very much. I'm going to show you three videos, and the message which I would like to share with you, or to share with you why the Israeli high-tech industry is so vibrant. And what I'm going to share with you is showing you that innovation and creativity is not work, it's a lot of fun. And when people have joy, they are doing things they love, you get terrific results. This explains the energy and the vibrant, the electricity in there in Israel. I'm going to show you a clip from a camp which I'm running once a year at the Lake of Galilee. It's a camp where all kinds of people which are totally out of the box are aggregating, like 280 of them, like 80 from the United States, 200 from Israel. And they are doing wonderful things. All these things have two things in common. They are smart and they are useless. So this is the meeting of the smart of useless. We celebrate it every year for 3 days, and here it is. And this is one of the secrets of the success of the Israeli high tech. User-generated event, people write the content. You have some of the brightest brains in Israel and abroad in this meeting. We show the transfer data with snails is faster than with ADSL. This is an Israeli company called Friendly Robotics. So these were some highlights of the, these guys are the guys that 363 days a year are doing serious work, and 3 days they are playing with their friends. This year we made a clip with all the participants of the camp, and it's something which is called the Lip Dub. You take a song and you let the people play and look at the joy on their faces.
Stop me now. Don't stop me.
'Cause I'm having a good time.
Having a good time.
I'm a shooting star leaping through the sky like a tiger, defying the laws of gravity. I'm a racing car passing by like Lady Godiva. I'm gonna go, go, go. There's no stopping me.
Dean of Computer Science in the IDC.
I'm having such a good time. I'm having a ball.
Don't stop me now.
If you want to have a good time, just give me a call.
Cisco Society of Responsibility. This guy, the captain, built a yacht in his backyard in Herzliya.
I'm a rocket ship on my way to Mars. On a collision course, I am a satellite. I'm out of control.
Dali Ross has a startup.
Like an atom bomb.
Explode.
The president of Yandex, the biggest search engine in Russia.
I'm traveling at the speed of light. I want to make a supersonic woman of you.
Don't stop me, don't stop me, don't stop me.
Hey, hey, hey.
I didn't know what to do with the guitar.
Sonic man out of you.
Stop me now. I'm having such a good time. I'm having a ball.
Don't stop me now.
If you wanna have a good time, just give me a call.
Don't stop me now.
I'm having a good time.
Don't stop me
yes,
now.
I'm having a good time.
I don't wanna stop.
So this gave you two snapshots. Now I would like to take 10 minutes of your time to something which doesn't have to, which don't or does have to do with the conference. And I feel I have to do it because of the current situation that we are facing. I would like to rehearse with you some of the fundamentals. And instead of me doing it, I will play now a speech that your neighbor from the north, the Prime Minister of Canada, gave at the occasion of 60 years for the State of Israel. I think this is a terrific speech rehearsing the fundamentals. If you like what you hear, take the link, send it to your friend. If you think it's a waste of your time, I really apologize, but I don't care. This is a shameless propaganda.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you for that tremendously warm welcome. And thank you, Ivan, for that introduction. Consul General Gissing, Minister Jim Flaherty, Leader of the Opposition John Tory, colleagues from the federal and provincial legislatures, members of the United Jewish Appeal Federation, ladies and gentlemen, mesdames et messieurs, je suis très honoré de participer aux célébrations de ce soir entourant le 60e anniversaire de la Fondation de l'État d'Israël. I am truly honored to be part of tonight's celebration. All of my life, Israel has been a symbol of the triumph of hope and faith. After 1945, our battered world desperately needed to be lifted out of post-war darkness and despair. After so much pain and suffering, humanity needed comfort and optimism. After so much death and destruction, we needed renewal. The renewal of the dream of a better and more civilized world. In short, we needed to be inspired. And it was the people who had suffered most who provided that inspiration. By their example, they led the world back to the light. From shattered Europe and other countries, near and far, the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob made their way home. Their pilgrimage was the culmination of a 2,000-year-old dream. It is a tribute to the unquenchable human aspiration for freedom and a testament to the indomitable spirit of the Jewish people. Ces 60 dernières années, Israël est devenu l'un des pays les plus prospères du monde. In the 60 years that followed, Israel blossomed into one of the most successful countries on earth. A land of ingenuity and enterprise, an oasis of agricultural genius, a wellspring of fine art and high culture, a model of democracy, Israel truly is the miracle in the desert. Mais à mon avis, Israël puise sa force et sa réussite dans son dévouement envers les valeurs universelles de tous les peuples civilisés. La liberté, la démocratie, les droits de la personne et la primauté du droit. But the source of Israel's strength and success is, in my view, its commitment to the universal values of all civilized people: freedom, democracy, human rights, and the rule of law. Soon I hope to have the opportunity to travel to Israel to see the miracle with my own eyes, to see how millions to see how millions of people from all over the earth, with their countless different languages and traditions, came together to build a modern, prosperous, vibrant, democratic country. It is a pilgrimage I have wanted to make for a long time, but my determination to do so was redoubled this spring after I visited Auschwitz. I want to see firsthand what the survivors of the Holocaust and their descendants have accomplished, for theirs is truly an achievement of resilience and renewal unsurpassed in the annals of human history. I also want to go to deliver in person the message of Canada's unshakable support for Israel. Malheureusement, à 60 ans, Israël demeure un pays menacé. Menacé par les groupes et par les régimes qui nient jusqu'à ce jour son droit d'exister. Unfortunately, Israel at 60 remains a country under threat, threatened by those groups and regimes who deny to this very day its right to exist. And why? And why, friends? Make no mistake, look beyond the thinly veiled rationalizations. Because they hate Israel just as they hate the Jewish people. Let me tell you, friends, our government believes that those who threaten Israel also threaten Canada. Because, friends, as the last World War showed, hate-fueled bigotry against some is ultimately a threat to us all and must be resisted wherever it may lurk. Dans cette bataille incessante, le Canada est côte à côte avec l'État d'Israël, notre ami et allié dans la famille démocratique des nations. In this ongoing battle, Canada stands side by side with the State of Israel, our friend and ally in the democratic family of nations. We have stood with Israel even when it has not been popular to do so, and we will continue to stand with Israel just as we have said we would. I know that we all hope and pray that someday freedom, democracy, human rights, and the rule of law will be a reality for all the peoples of the Middle East. Enshrining these values is the best way to assure lasting peace for Israelis and Palestinians alike. Les fondations d'un avenir pacifique existent. De façon individuelle, partout en Terre Sainte, les gens de toutes les confessions veulent ce que nous voulons tous et toutes. The foundations for a peaceful future are there. At the individual level, throughout the Holy Land, people of all faiths only want what all of us want. A safe place to live, a fair opportunity to get ahead, a good life for our children, a future for our grandchildren. So as we gather tonight to celebrate the first 60 years of the State of Israel, let us resolve as Canadians to do whatever we can do to support Israelis and their neighbors in their quest for a better future. There, Friends, there will be many challenges along the way. But considering how far Israel has come in so short a time, in the face of such seemingly insurmountable odds, I can foresee no dark force, no matter how strong, that could succeed in dimming the light of freedom and democracy that shines from within Israel. Thank you very much. Happy 60th anniversary. Merci beaucoup. Shalom.
Let's not forget the fundamentals. Thank you.
Thank you, Yossi. We love the fun and we love the serious, and it touches our heart. I'm going to ask you all to take a little refreshment break with some chocolate-covered strawberries and some cheese courtesy of Tanuva. But come back in here in 15 minutes because the president of Google is going to come and talk to us, and we're going to have some wild times with technology that'll be exciting for all of you. Thank you very much.